Chapter 15. The Big Fight.
Do you know what time it is?
Thorn's mother snapped.
We've been waiting all night for you to come home, Thornapple. If we don't hurry, we'll be late.
Thorn swallowed hard and asked,
Late for what?
Mrs. Trudel threw both hands into the air.
Your birthday surprise! We're taking you to the big fight tonight!
You're kidding me! I thought it was sold out!
It is sold out, but we bought our tickets early!
She turned her head and yelled into the house.
Honey, they're here! Let's go!
One moment, sweetie. I'm just finishing up on the news.
She twisted her lips and murmured,
Oh, you're just finishing up on the news.
Mrs. Trudel marched into the house, followed by Thorn, Tanya, and Simon. They found Dr. Trudel watching the news from a semi-holographic projection that emitted from Har's security collar. The poor kid was foaming at the mouth, and he couldn't seem to keep his eyes focused on anything. All three teenagers looked at each other nervously as the tiny reporter presented the news.
Earlier today, every single willow tree in the Zapanine Forest was mysteriously torn down. Specialists on the scene have told us that there is no scientific explanation for this phenomena, yet they are not ruling out foul play. Authorities have no comment at this time. On another note, 11 more Draguno attacks were reported today. One attack involving a daycare facility. Two big pugs were killed protecting their owners, and 5 more were severely injured. Scientists still haven't discovered where these reptiles are coming from, but they assured us that the situation is under control.
Mrs. Trudel pressed a button on Har's collar, and the 3D projection turned off.
All right, let's go.
Hey, I was watching that,
Dr. Trudel said.
You can watch it when we get back.
She turned to Har, who was drooling profusely onto the gray carpet, and commanded,
Har, record the news.
A red light on his security collar blinked on and off, indicating that the news was being recorded from the holonet.
Honey, if you don't hurry it up, we'll miss the first round.
I'm going the speed limit, sweetie. Just be patient. We'll be there before you know it.
Because of the awkwardly designed vehicle, Simon was forced to sit with his head between his knees, and Tanya was obliged to curl up on the seat with her legs folded over in a sort of kneeling position. And of course, there wasn't enough room to bring Simon's hover chair, so they left it at home.
Honey, maybe I should drive,
Mrs. Trudel said.
We're almost to the highway. Oh, look at that line.
They slowed down to a crawl.
It looks like we're not the only ones headed for the big fight.
Mrs. Trudel pulled on a lever, and the car lurched upwards and started to fly over the long row of cars ahead of them.
You're going to get me pulled over,
the doctor said, steering the vehicle upwards. He cut into a row of traffic that flew overhead. Simon felt his stomach drop as they sped onwards. Soon, a small flying ball zoomed up to the front window, and a mechanical voice asked,
Destination.
Hollywhip Stadium,
Dr. Trudel said.
Destination confirmed. Directions are now mapped out. Please sit back and enjoy the trip.
A white light shot out of the metallic ball and engulfed the car in a strange glowing web. It dragged the vehicle through the highway, hopping from lane to lane to make their journey as efficient as possible. Looking out the side window, Simon noticed similar devices leading the other cars as well. A series of tall buildings came into view. Because Simon had never been in the inner city before, he didn't realize how grand it really was. The building stood so high, he could scarcely see the ground below. Holographic billboards lined the invisible highway, advertising themes such as schools of higher learning, new advancements in security collars, items for conducting experiments, special seminars on science, and even informational books on how to potty train your big pud. Vehicles of all shapes and sizes flooded the entire sky, For a race of people who didn't seem to care much about anything other than science, the little Pudge sure did have a huge variety of flying cars. And if it weren't for the aid of the floating balls, the whole network of highways would be in total chaos. But, surprisingly, every car was able to compensate for variances in the wind and openings created when cars jumped to different roadways or lanes. As they neared the tallest building, their car started to sputter and cough. Suddenly, the tractor beam surrounding the vehicle shorted out, forcing the car to break loose from the highway and fall.
Oh, great.
Dr. Trudel mumbled under his breath.
I've been meaning to get the magnetron converter fixed. Hold on, everybody!
They dove through several rows of cars, all of which moved out of the way in perfect unison. The metallic ball chased after them frantically.
Malfunction. The magnetic coupling has been disengaged,
came the mechanical voice.
There is no need to panic. Please stay calm while I attempt to regain control of the vehicle.
That's easy for you to say,
Mrs. Trudel said. She pulled down on the throttle to help bring the car out of its nosedive. Abruptly, the car shot upwards, and everyone fell back against their seats. All the while, the flying ball kept shooting its tractor beam at them, but the web of light just couldn't seem to take hold. Now the car was rising higher and higher, dispersing traffic like a speedboat cutting through water. Dr. Trudel smashed through four floating billboards in succession, and then leveled off long enough to scatter a line of cars that were waiting to get into the parking lot on the top of the largest building. Thorn screamed as they raced towards a tall partition that separated the Colosseum from the parking lot. Then, just before they were pulverized against the wall, the metal orb that had been trailing behind finally grabbed hold of the vehicle.
Destination arrived. I hope you enjoyed the trip,
it said, as they came to an abrupt halt. The ball gently rested the car onto a convenient parking space near the entrance.
Well,
Mrs. Trudel said, brushing her hair out of her face.
That was a nice shortcut. We're not even late.
The arena sat on top of the building like a bowl. Spotlights danced around the noisy crowd, and the smell of food filled the air. Everyone around them seemed to be staring at Tanya. It wasn't every day they saw a tall, green-haired alien in their midst.
You guys didn't get any dinner, did you?
Yelled Dr. Trudel over the cheers of the crowd.
Here, take this!
He gave some money to each of them.
Thanks,
all three of them said. Tanya and Thorn raced to the concession stands, while Simon trailed sluggishly behind. He took one look at the selection and decided to go hungry. Thorn ordered a chicken wing, feathers and all, and Tanya ordered some deep-fried rhubarb.
Aren't you going to get anything?
Thorn asked Simon.
I'm not too hungry.
Just then, the crowd roared. The announcer said in an exaggerated voice,
To my left, we have the challenger, Alvin Bottlebrush! He has been fighting professionally for 2 years now. His favorite science is chemistry, and he holds 2 doctorates in biology. And girls, I hear he's single!
The noise was deafening. Everyone but Simon turned around to get a closer look.
Come on, kids! Let's go!
Mrs. Trudel urged. Simon exchanged his money for something sealed in a white plastic wrapper. He promptly put the item in his fanny pack before anybody could see. The announcer spoke again.
And to my right, we have the champion, Bobob Dungbeat! Mr. Dungbeat has never lost a fight yet! He enjoys chemical engineering and computer science! He is currently studying at Highland City's very own Northcliffe University, where he hopes to teach someday!
Simon made it to his seat just in time to see 2 small puds strutting around the stage, flexing their muscles like bodybuilders. He thought it odd that such a civilized people would endorse a violent sport such as boxing. Mrs. Trudel seemed especially interested in Alvin Bottlebrush, who was clearly the better looking of the 2 fighters.
The rules are simple,
the announcer continued.
Keep it clean while the blue light is on, nothing below the belt. Watch for the chaos light. When you see it, you'll have 30 seconds of no holds barred. Good luck, gentlemen. Shake hands and let the fight begin.
The two boxers attempted to shake hands, but their gloves proved too cumbersome. They then turned around and left the ring, which Simon found very confusing. Standing just outside the ropes, each fighter was outfitted with wires and electrodes that led to a plastic headband. The crowd screamed wildly as two trap doors opened up on the stage. Slowly, two giant figures emerged from the floor. They were the biggest puds Simon and Tanya had ever seen. Simon still didn't know what was going on until he saw the big puds start to fight. Somehow, the large men were being remotely controlled by the little puds. For instance, every time Alvin or Bobob swung an arm, their counterpart in the ring would swing his arm as well. The two giants exchanged blows to the face, one after the other, until Bobob's pud began to bleed from a cut under his eye.
This is barbaric!
Tanya cried.
Yeah, this doesn't seem very fair, Simon said.
Thorn smiled.
Don't worry, guys! The pain receptors aren't transmitted to the little puds, just the movement! Alvin and Bobob are quite all right!
Tanya rolled her eyes in response. The blue light that surged through the top rope surrounding the ring started to flash the primary colors.
It's berserk time!
Exclaimed the announcer over the roar of the crowd. The large puds ran to the sideline and quickly picked out weapons. Bobob selected a wooden bat, and Alvin chose two rubber batons. In a demonic fury, the giants lashed out at each other. At first, it looked like Alvin was going to lose the fight. Bobob kept hitting Alvin's fighter across the back, but then his bat suddenly shattered. With 2 seconds left in the round, Alvin clashed his hands together as if he were clanging two cymbals. His pud followed suit by smashing the rubber batons against the other pud's sides. A loud buzzer rang, and the round ended. Tanya turned to Mrs. Trudel, who was clapping like crazy, and yelled over the hysteria of the crowd,
I thought little puds didn't have time for frivolous things! This fight doesn't seem like a very productive use of your time. Kanya, you're missing the whole point. The fight is just a demonstration of the new advancements in security collars. We're getting a peek at the future. At the expense of injuring two helpless people?
I wouldn't really call them people, Kanya.
Dr. Trudel chimed in.
The whole purpose of this line of science is to control the animalistic nature of the big puds. I can't even imagine what the world would become like if we didn't have security measures like this.
Tanya murmured under her breath.
I don't think it's the big puds with the animalistic nature.
The buzzer rang, and round two began. Sweat poured down the bodies of the large puds, causing their muscles to glisten in the spotlight. Even their owners perspired as they threw their fists into the air. Simon thought it strange to see the dramatic expressions on Alvin Bottlebrush's face as he shadowboxed in unison with his big pud. Bobob Dungbeat, on the other hand, remained cool and collected. Every movement he made was well thought out and purposeful. During this round, the fighters became much more rambunctious than before. They used their feet to kick, and they danced around the mat to avoid getting hit. Although Bobob and Alvin were somewhat hindered in what they could do, they were still able to maneuver their fighters around with remarkable skill. The crowd roared with excitement when the chaos light flashed again. Alvin, the challenger, made his pud run to the sideline to get a weapon. This time the selection was more deadly than before. His fighter picked up a knife, but before the large man could turn around to use it, Bobob's pud kneed him in the back. Being a more experienced fighter, Bobob had decided that, instead of getting a weapon, he would make a surprise attack instead. After Bobob completed his first assault, he compelled his fighter to pick up Alvin's Pud and throw him off the stage. Bobob raised his feet as though climbing a ladder, which in turn forced his Pud to climb up the ropes and stand on the top rung. The little Pud waved to the crowd, and then threw himself to the ground. His Pud did the same, but instead of hitting the mat, he smashed heavily onto the other big Pud.
"Ooh, that's gotta hurt," the announcer commented. "If Mr. Bottlebrush doesn't start doing better soon, he's gonna have to find himself a new Pud."
The crowd laughed, and the round ended. Simon turned to Thorn and asked,
"They don't kill each other, do they?"
"No! Hardly anyone ever gets killed,"
Thorn replied.
"They just beat each other up until one of them can't fight anymore."
"Animals!"
Tanya spat.
"Yes, they are animals,"
Thorn said.
"I meant you! Everyone here! Except for the ones in the ring! You're all animals!"
Thorn screwed up his face.
"How can you say we're animals? Look at what we can accomplish! We have the power to control!"
"Your people are the real animals because you don't seem to have the power for compassion."
She stood up, and everyone around them gasped at seeing her long red hair.
"Civilized people don't take advantage of others. They treat each other with equality and civility."
Simon perked up when she used those words.
"Your technological advancements are worthless if they don't help you to become better people. Even my father wouldn't participate in something like this."
"Sit down, young lady,"
Dr. Trudel said in a stern voice. Deeply embarrassed, Mrs. Trudel hid her face so that none of her peers would recognize her.
"No, I won't sit down. I won't just sit and watch this go on any longer. Come on, Simon, let's stop this fight right now."
She grabbed the boy's arm, but he resisted.
"There's nothing we can do," Simon said, staring at the floor.
"There's always something you can do,"
she scolded.
"Simon, you need to stand up for what's right. When a problem comes up, you can't just ignore it and hope it goes away."
But
nothing! Listen to me, Runt. You and I don't really meet this Paraworld's intellectual standards. You never know. Maybe after a while, they'll turn us into slaves as well."
Her words pierced his heart like a knife, and he felt awful that he had been so passive about the whole thing. Feeling a strange courage he had never felt before, Simon leapt from his seat and followed Tanya down the steps towards the stage. He vowed never again to look the other way when someone needed him. A million thoughts ran through his head. He wondered if there was a spell he could use to free the giants. Perhaps he could transport them out of the city, but what if he couldn't control the magic? And how would the little Pudge react to his spell? Now was not the time to doubt. He looked up and saw that Bobob's Pud held some type of revolving blade, like a chainsaw. Alvin's Pud had only a rod of iron to defend himself. The chaos light flashed wildly. Simon and Tanya were almost to the stage when the big Pud who wielded the chainsaw took a swipe at his opponent, slashing him across the abdomen, but only slightly. The injured man doubled over from the pain, and the crowd went wild. Fortunately for Alvin, the thin blade had only grazed his Pud. Bobob raised his hands up high and readied himself for the kill. The heartless crowd screamed in approval. Without warning, Alvin Bottlebrush thrust up his hands, causing his Pud to swing the rod of iron with all his might at his would-be executioner. The rod struck the other Pud across the neck so forcefully that it knocked him backwards onto the mat. Staggering to his feet, the giant clutched his throat and broke off the shattered collar that had saved his life. He looked around the ring in a dazed stupor. Suddenly, he made eye contact with Bobob, and a spark of hatred ignited within him. He charged at his master full force, but before he reached the ropes, the other big Pud, controlled by Alvin, tackled him to the ground. Half a dozen little Puds jumped into the ring to help. They zapped the fallen giant with energy sticks that flared with every jab. Determined, the large pud grasped through the ropes at his master, but he couldn't quite reach. Bobob Dungbeat just stood there with a solemn look etched across his face. He had just been defeated for the first time. Simon covered his ears to drown out the screams from the hysterical crowd. He looked around at the people in dismay. Many raised their fists and jeered or called out for a rematch. Some were disappointed, while others overjoyed. Most of the puds near the Trudles had not recovered from seeing Tanya's flaming red hair and overhearing her derogatory comments. Neither had Mrs. Trudle. The doctor stood by his wife, statue-like, except for the tightening of his clenched jaw muscles. Thornapple hung his head down. A gulf seemed to separate Simon from his tiny friend. The Earthling had turned his back to the family who had taken him in. He had trodden over their culture, embarrassed them beyond measure. And for what? Nothing had changed. Nothing he did would ever make a difference.
"Thank you,"
came a broken whisper from within the chaos. Simon turned to Tanya and saw the tears streaming down her face. He reached over to pat her shoulder or to hold her hand, anything to comfort her. She threw her arms around his neck and sobbed.
"Thank you, Simon,"
she said again.
"You stood by my side when no one else would. Thank you."
Simon held her amidst the roaring crowd. He closed his eyes and opened them a few seconds later. Further up the Colosseum, he spotted Thornapple, standing in the aisle alone. His parents were already marching towards the exit. Thornapple's ashen face remained void of expression, the gleam gone from his sullen eyes, his customary smile dissolved from his face. The little pud gazed at Simon and Tanya with big, troubled eyes. All Simon could do in response was stare back and frown. A shiver of dread ran down his spine. What was he doing on this strange planet? He didn't belong on Pluto. He wasn't sure if he belonged on Earth either, but at least there he knew where he stood. Had his friendship with Thornapple just been severed, torn apart, along with half of his heart? Tanya held the other half. Simon embraced her more tightly and wondered what the future would bring, now that his world had just been turned upside down.